Hey guys, what's up? It is Sam Cook for Sam Cook Live, and on today's show, I'm so excited, Hamiltonian musician, winner of Canadian Idol, this is Mr. Brian Melo. So excited to chat with you today. We have so much to talk about. I can't wait. So let's get started now on Sam Cook Live.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Here we go.
This is Sam Cook Live.
Brian Melo, live in studio, superstar extraordinaire. Do you feel like one?
No, I'm just Brian. No.
Just Brian never from Hamilton.
Yeah, that's what it is.
And you are doing so well in your career right now. You're living in the States, and we're going to talk about all of that. Mm-hmm. But I kind of want to go back to the beginning.
Okay.
Back to when you were a kid. Did you always know you wanted to sing?
Yeah, I think so. You know, I have two older brothers, and they were in these like Portuguese English like wedding bands.
So, really?
Yeah, yeah. So they would do like the Ontario circuit and stuff. And I think the earliest like music memory for me was they were doing this festival, and I was there, and all the kids were playing around the hall, and I was just standing by the stage because my brothers were like just superheroes to me, you know? So they knew I had an interest at a young age, and they called me up and gave me a tambourine. and that was the bug, because, you know, you're this kid, you're on stage, and then 200 people clapping for you instantly.
Yeah.
Once you get that experience, especially at that age, you kind of get hit with the bug early. So I did, but I didn't really end up taking it seriously until, you know, probably like after high school, when I really thought, okay, let's dive all the way in.
Now, I heard that you had someone in high school that kind of pushed you to mm-hmm. do maybe Canadian Idol. Is there any truth to that, or kind of led you in that direction? Did you have a...
Not Canadian Idol, but her name was Mrs. Linda Gatto, and she was one of my first music mentors. Mm-hmm. And I enrolled for a vocal class in grade 11, and to be completely honest, it was for an easy credit. I thought, I'm going to sing a little bit,
yeah.
You know, but I was a pretty shy kid at that point. So, my parents and my family didn't even know I could sing until I was like 17.
Really?
Because I just kind of kept it to myself, and I just did it as a pastime. And when I went into this classroom, the first day of class, she started doing do re mi's for each student. In class, and it got to me, I got a pretty good reaction, and she saw something in me. And she, the thing with her that was so astonishing is she believed in me before I believed in myself. And she started to give me solos in school and told me to become comfortable with being uncomfortable, and I use that till this day. And I stepped out and started to perform, and I started to get, you know, these reactions from friends and family that thought I had something. So that was kind of one of those first seeds that started to take root, because it just started to let me know that if I just keep on going on like through this path, that the potential, you know, could go as far as I want it to go. So she had a huge role in that, and then unfortunately she passed away from cancer when I was in high school. And I'll be doing a show in Hamilton and dedicating the show to her as well. But she it's just amazing what teachers can do when they see something in a student, and I'm a perfect example for that. So yeah, it was she was very important to me.
And you actually are a teacher now, yeah, with a program that you have that we'll talk about as well. Melo Tree is the name of that program.
Yeah.
And but I want to kind of go back after high school, and she saw something in you. I'm assuming like that gave you a bit of confidence, mm-hmm, and the confidence to audition for Canadian Idol.
Yeah.
And this was kind of, I think, kind of so eye-opening for a lot of people to see these musicians and to understand that Canada has talent.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, because a lot of times people are like all about the U.S. at that time anyways. It was all about the U.S. singers, and Canada didn't have a lot of talent. And when I was in radio at the time, mm-hmm, that was kind of the mentality. And then, you know, you come out of the woodworks, and like now we have all these, you know, we have Drake and Bieber, and we have you, and we have all these people that are doing so well. And that was kind of your start. So how did that feel, being on that Canadian Idol stage?
It was surreal. It really was. And the thing that a lot of people don't know is that was the third time that I tried out.
Really? And so you were on season 5.
I was on season 5. And I went for the first couple times, and straight up, I just wasn't ready, you know? And I got great constructive criticism from the people there, and I passed a couple rounds, but I just needed more experience. So after those first two times, I was like, I don't know if it's for me. And I had a band by, at that time, called Stoked, and we were doing, like, the bar scene. Around Hamilton.
I love the name.
Yeah, well, the name is what it is. One of the hardest things you can ever do is name your band, you know? And I think we went through five names, and I think we settled with Stoked. But we would do the circuit and stuff, and I was just kind of focusing on that. And at this point, I really, really started to get a lot of shows under my belt. I started to focus on my vocals a lot more, focus on my writing a lot more. So I just felt that I was ready. And my brother and my best friend, it was probably a week before the auditions, and they told me to go and give it a shot. And at the time, like, I just went in to see, is this something that I can do at a professional level,
right?
or am I just kidding myself?
Right,
I was
right.
never thinking of, I want to go win this thing. That wasn't even a thought in my mind, you know? It was just about, am I kidding myself? Can I just go in there and see what I got against other great talent? And, you know, I started with one goal, you know, and it was like, get to the celebrity judges. Okay, I did that. And then from there, I got to the, you know, top 200. And then I was hoping to get to top 22. And then from there, I would be happy if we got to top 10. And it was like, it was just these goals that I was slowly set. And then all of a sudden, I was like, oh, wait, maybe I can win this thing, right?
Yeah.
But it was an incredible experience because I got to meet incredible mentors and people in the industry, and I learned so much from them. The camaraderie that I had with the staff and the contestants that were on the show was amazing. And I mean, it was like this rock star boot camp for 4 months where I was learning so much with these mentors and these musicians, and learning how to rehearse correctly, you know, learning how to take care of my voice, how to be a dynamic performer, you know. So it did tons for me when I was on that show.
So I love watching American Idol. I love America's Got Talent. I love all these reality shows. And in fact, I just watched America's Got Talent the other day, The Champions. And I get so excited sitting there when they're like, and the winner is, and the music's going da, 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 you know, and you're waiting to find out who the winner is. So for you, you won Canadian Idol. Like, you won it.
Yeah.
Like, so you're like the best in Canada. In that moment, standing on that stage, you are the best. What are you thinking in your head when it was between J.D. Bixby and you? And they're like, and the winner is, and in that moment when he says the word is and he says your name, are you thinking, holy shit, like, this could be me?
Yeah.
What are you thinking?
Holy shit is a good way to put it, because it lasted a matter of seconds when he said it, but it felt forever, you know? I mean, if you ever see my reaction, it's like, you know, I'm not the type to, like, jump up and down, but I literally, like, my shoulders went down, my head went down, because it was like this relief, you know?
Like,
and
I did it.
Yeah, it was just, it was incredible. And then when I'm looking out into the crowd and I'm seeing my brothers, my sister, my parents, my friends, it was just, it really was those pinch me moments that only happen once in someone's life if you're lucky. And I feel very fortunate. I just feel very grateful because there's tons of incredible talent in Canada. And luckily Canada saw something in me. It was just an incredible experience. It's really hard to put into words, you know? And but at the same time, you know, that's almost where the work starts, like, after the show.
Right.
You know? And then you start to learn more about the industry after that as well, too. And that's a whole other journey within itself. But, I mean, what a ride. I mean, I loved every moment of it. I really did.
Now, when that's done and Brian Melo, and the confetti comes down and you're all... Is there a moment after you go home and go, oh, like, now what do I do? Like, was there a moment of fear, or were you like, this is it, this is my life? Like, how do you feel after you win a competition like that? Because I almost feel like there's a whole, like, you must feel so excited and so happy, but at the same time, almost like fear.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, there's always fear, you know? And I think, you know, with the nerves and fear, sometimes it can work for you or work against you. And I hate being scared. So I try to find ways to face that fear and move forward. And usually I realized that most of the fear was in my head and wasn't nearly as scary as I thought it would be. But I'll tell you, they knew what I was going to do after that show, because the next morning, I mean, I did the show. I had to wake up. We did the after party, which was insane and amazing.
I can imagine.
And I had to wake up by like 3:30 or 4 o'clock that morning because I had interviews. And before 10 o'clock in the morning, I did over about 50 or 60 interviews.
Are you serious?
So it was crazy. Lot. I mean, they would have phone conferences. There'd be 10 reporters and one, and each person was asking a question. It was super overwhelming, you know. And you're almost in a bit of a bubble, and you don't realize until maybe a couple years after. You're like, okay, that was kind of crazy, you know, but you know, so they kind of shoot you out of a cannon, but you just got to try to hold on, you know?
Well, when you say crazy, I want to grab my paper here because you've had some amazing big name celebrities say really great things about you. Kelly Clarkson, Brian May of Queen.
Yeah.
Who else? Enrique Iglesias, did I say that right? Yeah. Enrique Iglesias. And what is
Enrique?
Enrique. Yeah. But what does it feel like for someone like Enrique to say, like, you're amazing? Like that must feel so good.
It really did. I mean, it just gave me a lot of validation that I was on the right path.
Right.
Because you see these types of people that are at that level, and you know, you hope that you can hang. You know?
Yeah.
And so, you know, like, for example, Queen is one of they're it for me. I grew up on them. And so getting to sing Too Much Love Will Kill You in front of Roger Taylor and Brian May was insane. And then to get the response I got from them was just so gratifying and so validating. And it just built my confidence. It's like, well, if these guys think I have something, maybe I do, you know, and maybe I shouldn't be second guessing myself, you know? And so then I just tried to work twice as hard because these types of people believed in me.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
And now you're living in Nashville.
Yeah.
And you've got a band there, mm-hmm. and you're doing really well. And what's happening in Nashville? Give us a little taste of what's happening there and what goes on a daily basis, mm-hmm. in your life.
Well, I moved to Nashville about 4 years ago with my band Apollo's Crown. So we're a trio, kind of similar to, you know, Fleetwood Mac, Eagles, that kind of vibe. A lot of harmonies. So very, very vocal heavy. And we decided, I mean, all of us were sort of hitting a crossroads in our life and our career. And we decided to pack our bags and go down there. And I'm glad we did because we've been able to, you know, record at Studio A where Dolly Parton did Jolene, and
yeah.
you know, Elvis Presley did, you know, Suspicious Minds, and like all these incredible artists, and we've been able to do some incredible things down there. So, you know, we're constantly writing, we're constantly, you know, going into meetings, we're performing, obviously, and also I'm teaching songwriting, I'm teaching performance, state of mind, and just how to be a dynamic performer, and how you can use those types of traits into your everyday life as well, too.
So let's talk about that. So you teach Melo Tree is the name of, I guess it's an online program.
Now that I'm in Nashville, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is amazing. So if you're a singer-songwriter,
yeah.
they can work with you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so how does that work?
I do 8 to 10 sessions right now. And I don't spread myself too thin, mm-hmm. right now. So this is something that is just a passion project for me that I try to do when I'm down there in Nashville. And I'll have about 10 or 12 students right now. And I do a lot of co-writing with them. And also, just like I said before, a lot of like performance state of mind. Because I find a lot of these students are just lacking confidence and lacking belief. And like I said earlier, what my teacher said to me is become comfortable with being uncomfortable.
Right.
So sometimes you have to kind of break down the walls and the barriers of other things that are happening within your life before you can be a vulnerable performer, artist, right? So we try to figure that out with some of the artists and figure out what their goals are. Some of them just want a song, right? So we do that. And what I was doing before, I was doing the online program. I was doing it here in Hamilton at Studio E. And I would do classes. And I would have them go in to do co-writes, or I'd have them go up and perform. So I'll do that sometimes too when I get back home and if I have enough time to do that with the students here in Hamilton. But yeah, as of right now, we do the online programs and it's one-on-one, about, you know, 60 minutes to 2 hours sometimes.
Wow, that's cool. And that's really cool.
Yeah, yeah.
So what, do you Skype with them?
Yeah.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah. And then you just give them tips and tricks and help them. If they want to write a song, you help them write a song.
Yeah, a lot of it is songwriting right now, too. And yeah, that's basically what it is. We grab our guitars, let's get creative. You know, I always encourage people to keep that imagination going and get creative. And sometimes you can be your worst critic when you're by yourself. So having a co-writer or a mentor there with you to help you at least finish writing the songs is incredibly important, you know, because like I say, like, your first song isn't going to be as good as your 500th song.
Right.
So there is something in finishing songs, you know. So I like to get them in the habit, and hopefully when they walk away from that, they can continue to write and stay creative as well.
So how does one songwrite? Like, in my head, I imagine that, you know, you see a girl walk by and you say, ooh, she's kind of pretty. And then you go, oh, that's a great song title. And you write that, ooh, she's kind of pretty. Like, is that how the songwriting process sometimes works? I don't know.
You're not too far off. I mean, sometimes it can be like that, you know, that it could be a catchy phrase that that you hear and you want to build a concept around it. There's so many different ways on how to write a song. You know, you could pick up a guitar and it could be a great riff that inspires you. Sometimes I'll just be mumbling melodies and within that words will pop out, and it's almost like a puzzle revealing itself, you know? So sometimes I'll find the corner pieces of the puzzle. So, okay, what's the title? You know, and okay, that's going to be one corner piece. Okay, what's the start of the song? What's the story?
Okay, yeah.
And I break it down there, and when it starts to reveal itself, then, you know, you start to break it down in more detail and hooks and melody. But there's so many different ways on how you can start a song. I wouldn't say there's just one specific way.
Do you ever carry around like a journal where you're like, oh, and you're like in McDonald's, you're like, oh, hold on, I'll take my order in a second, or is there like,
it's voice memos for me.
So you've got your phone.
I have my phone, and I'll record an idea or I'll go to my notes,
like, day or night.
It doesn't stop. I if you and I are talking, I think in songs.
You're thinking the ooh, she's pretty song, aren't you, that I just said. You're like, oh, that's a great song title.
It's not a bad hook. You kind of had a good hook. I was like, maybe we'll finish the song when we finish this podcast.
Yeah, baby. So excited. So can. Here I come. Oh, that's so exciting. But, like, where's the craziest place you ever went? Oh, I have an idea. Like, is there a place where you went, I don't know.
Oh, man.
Making out with a girl, your girlfriend. You're like, well, hold on a second, babe. Like,
I try to be respectful, but I don't know. I mean, it comes from the most random places. But I think my friends almost get annoyed with me because they'll be in a in-depth conversation with me, like you are, and I'm like, that's a song, you know.
That's
and
it's
like,
good, though.
And
that's
then they're
good.
Like, aren't you listening to what I'm saying? I'm like, kinda,
kind of, you know.
But I'm trying to write as well too, so it can happen in the strangest places. But one specific location that stands out, I can't think of it, but it's as random as they come. It can happen at any moment.
Is there a song that you went, oh, I wish I wrote that song?
Oh my god. How much time do we have?
Give me a couple.
The whole Beatles catalog. Let's start with that.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I mean, I love Tennessee Whiskey from, I mean, I know Stapleton didn't write it, but his version's incredible. You know, some of Ed Sheeran's songs are amazing. I'm a huge John Mayer fan.
Yeah. Oh, he's, you're talking all the people that I love.
Yeah. So, like, Slow Dancing in a Burning Room. I mean, I love that song. Belief. Honestly, I can go on and on. There's so many artists that I love, and yeah, you know, I think about Eric Clapton too, like you know, Wonderful Tonight, you know, things like that.
There's these are all unbelievable songs.
Yeah,
but even like to this day, I still sing All I Ever Wanted. Was that your song, or is that someone else that wrote it?
Someone else wrote that one. Yeah, because
sing it. All I ever wanted, but life got in my way.
There you go.
Sorry, I'm so excited. Yeah, but he's so good. Oh my god. Fangirling.
But yeah, with that song, it was the winner single. So the writers worked on the song, and basically whoever won the show sang that song, and I won the show, and then at midnight, the song was going to radio.
So you kind of recorded that ahead of time, and they said, okay, whoever wins, that's the song we're going to release.
I think they had top three or top four recorded it. And then when it was done, then they put out your version, and there you go.
Now, I'm a singer-songwriter in my bedroom, and nobody knows about it, and I'm not telling anybody because I don't think I'm any good, but I really want to get started, but I don't know how. What are you going to tell me to make me live my dream?
I don't want to sound like a broken record, but like I say to a lot of my artists about become comfortable with being uncomfortable. I mean, I think that's so true. I was a scared kid before too. Again, I was in my shell, and if I didn't have moments where I just kind of jumped in, I wouldn't have met Linda Gatto. I wouldn't have gone to Idol. I mean, all those things, I was scared out of my mind, you know. But I think with fear, we can really build it up to be this this thing that it's not. I heard this great example of fear before, and it was like the Wizard of Oz. So, you know, the wizard is this big voice. Now think of that as fear, right? Okay. But once you face the fear and you pull the curtain, you see it's a scared little person, you know?
Yeah. Oh, that's,
And that always kind of rang true. And it's like, you know, if you kind of dance with fear and say, you know, I respect you. I know that you're going to be here. I know that you're always going to be here, but I'm not going to fight you. I'm going to dance with you, and we're going to figure out a way to get my goals done, you know? So that's what I would tell students is, what do you got to lose? Pick it up, play a song, you know? And the thing is, you need reference points.
You know? What do you mean by that? I don't understand what that means.
Well, for example, like take my reference point of winning Idol. That was impossible to me, right? I didn't even think that was a goal of mine.
Okay.
Now I've accomplished that, I have a reference point that's so big to me now.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
That when I think about it, I'm like, well, that was impossible to me and I did it. So the goals that I have ahead of myself now, why would I think they're impossible? You know what I mean? But if you don't go out and actually try to take some risks and put yourself out there, you're never going to get those types of reference points, you know? And I think with the students that I'm working with now, all of a sudden they've never written a song before and they write a couple songs with me and they're like, whoa, okay, wait a second. I could actually write a song and I'm actually more talented than I thought I was. So I think don't be afraid to put yourself out there, and I'm sure you'll surprise yourself most of the time.
When you talk about fear, how scared were you to pick up everything, move away from your family in Hamilton, and say, I'm going to Nashville? Because I can't imagine that being easy. Because I know when I was younger, I picked up everything and moved to New York City. Mm-hmm. And then my parents dropped me off, left, and I went, whoa, I'm here and this is real.
Yeah. Yeah. It was scary and unsettling, but I mean, I've always been type to sort of embrace the uncertainty, you know, and I have, again, going back to the whole reference points, because I have those in the back of my mind that I've done this before, that I have confidence in myself that even if it doesn't work out, I'm going to figure out a way. Mm-hmm. I'm going to figure out another way I'm going to learn something from this. And I knew that the option of always coming back home to my family and to my friends is there, you know? So I thought, you know, I'm at a certain point in my life, a certain age in my life, that if I don't do it now,
that's right,
when, mm-hmm, you know, and I just, you know, I didn't really overthink it. I just, you know, things happen for a reason. I'm a believer of that as well too. Yeah. And when we hopped in a van and decided to go down there, we weren't even a band yet. We were just, you know, friends on a journey where Andrew and Victoria, my bandmates, they were in a duel together and I was doing my solo thing. They met in Hong Kong, of all places.
Really?
And wow. they were performing at this dinner theater in Hong Kong. And they're engaged. They're going to be getting married really soon. So
wow, that's incredible. That's incredible.
But they came down, and I was judging a songwriting contest in Hamilton. And it was write a song in 24 hours. And there are certain stipulations that you had to follow and stuff. So they went in last second to do the contest, and they won. They blew me away. And wow, at that point, you know, I wanted a female to sing some backup with me because I was doing more like rock songs, and some of the guys were having trouble singing some of those high harmonies.
Right, right.
So so we had an opportunity. She came in, and Andrew came in because my guitar player canceled at the time, and he came in, and we just built this incredible friendship. Started to do some cool things. We opened up for Chicago, which was awesome.
What?
You know, we got to do some pretty fantastic stuff together.
Wow, and that's incredible.
Yeah, and then it got to the point where it's like, you know, let's all hop in a car, let's go to Nashville. Still not a band, but let's come up with a band name.
Let's do it.
So that if someone, you know, someone meets us, it's not like we have an identity crisis. Like, oh, I'm Brian Melo. This is Andrew.
Yeah, this is someone else who does this. Yeah.
Yeah. So we went in, but through that we wrote eight. we wrote about eight songs in a week,
right.
And left as a band. you know, and we started to go back for every 5-6 weeks. We go back again and we'd meet people and we'd build more momentum. Mm-hmm. So that first year, we built the momentum. We kind of like spread the seeds there. And then finally we got to a point and said, you know what, let's try to go for a visa and let's really dive in and give it a shot.
Nice.
So Nashville was sort of pulling us after that first year of all our visits.
Oh, and Nashville is just such an amazing,
yeah,
amazing place to even visit, to live there. It must be like unbelievable.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's one of the fastest growing cities in America, and even for the time I've been there, it's crazy to see how much it's grown. But I love it. It's an awesome town. But it's like you were saying earlier, like leaving your home, like Hamilton is always home for me.
Yeah.
Like you can't take it away from me. So, and I'm so close to my family, my friends, my girlfriend still lives here in Hamilton. So there's a lot here for me as well. So for me, it's always about juggling that balance of both lives, you know, because Nashville gives me something that Hamilton necessarily might not, but Hamilton definitely gives me something that Nashville can't. So kind of balancing both worlds for me is probably the trickiest thing. So,
and I know that Hamilton absolutely loves you. I mean, I remember in, what was it, 2007 when you were on Canadian Idol?
Yeah, it's going back now. It's crazy.
It's going back, but I remember the streets filled with like lawn signs, you know, vote for Brian. And so Hamilton definitely,
it's like I was going for council or something.
It did look like that. It really did. But, you know, Hamilton will always have your back. In fact, I could be wrong. I don't even, now I'm kind of feeling weird about asking this, but don't you have like a day? Isn't there like a Brian Melo day? Is there?
Well,
or am I not remembering correctly?
Yeah, they devoted a day to me on October.
Brian Melo day when?
It was after the show. It's not like an annual thing. It's not like people get off school for the day or anything like that and celebrate my life.
I thought I could maybe use that and tell my boss, Melo Day, I'm not coming in today.
Yeah, I wish, but I had it for about a year or two, which was cool.
That is
cool. But they dedicated it to, stuff like that's just bizarre to me, you know? So
Brian Melo Day. That's so cool. No one can say they had a day dedicated to themselves.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
That is really cool. Now, when you're in Nashville, I mean, this is all a lot for you. I mean, just for anybody, I mean, being on the show, now you're in Nashville and you're meeting all these famous people, and all these famous people are saying great things about you. What do you do to just go, namaste? Like, what do you do to just be calm? Do you have, like, any rituals? Do you do yoga? Do you?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I'm a big believer of kind of self-love, you know, and finding a routine that works for you. So I've done, I don't know if you ever heard of Wim Hof and the Wim Hof breathing method.
No, but I need to. Can you explain what that is? Because I've never heard of that.
I'll try my best. They call him the Iceman. So he can go into like sub-zero temperatures water, and the temperature in his body doesn't change at all through this breathing technique. And it helps build your immune system. It can kind of reboot your nervous system as well. So I'll wake up and I'll do this breathing technique, and I highly advise, check out Wim Hof on YouTube. He can explain it much better than I can.
Okay, so say it again. What is it? Wim Hof?
It's his name. Yeah. And it's a man from, I want to say the Netherlands. And he was going through a tough time and lost his wife and was dealing with all these emotions, and he found it through cold plunges and his breath. So basically taking cold showers, I do a lot, breathing. I know it sucks, but I almost look at it like okay, if I can deal with this, you know what I mean? It's uncomfortable for me. What else can I deal with throughout the day?
Yeah.
So I'll do that. I also meditate. So I like to medicate. I don't medicate.
Do that too?
Yeah, I do that on the weekend. No. Yeah. Meditate. I've done a practice called Qigong. I don't know if you've heard of that.
No.
And it's kind of like the art of effortless power. You know, I'm really into this kind of stuff.
No, I am too. So I want to learn about it.
Yeah. So it's basically like these movements that, you know, similar, almost like yoga movements, but not, or Tai Chi.
Yeah. So Tai Chi is kind of slow and.
Yeah. And you'll hit certain points in your body that kind of ignite your energy and your Chi. And it just sort of helps realign me sometimes. And then besides that, I like to journal sometimes too, and obviously the gym. So I like to sweat at least once a day, and then hopefully eat right. I feel better when I eat right too. And my background's Portuguese, so when I come home, it's the hardest because Mama Melo starts cooking up a storm. So I got to be careful there. But I just those are a few things that I do. But I try to create a routine that is going to kind of, if I can win the morning, I can win the day. So I try to do something, you know, each morning that kind of sets the tone.
And it's funny because I had a guest on my show a couple of weeks ago, and I was telling her that at night I write a couple things that I'm grateful for throughout mm-hmm. the day. And she said, well, that's great, but starting your day by writing things that you're grateful for is better than doing it at night. And now you're the second guest on my show that says you do things in the morning to kind of set the tone for your day.
Yeah, yeah.
Huh.
So I would agree with both. I think doing a morning routine and a night routine before you go to bed, I think is great for your subconscious, you know? So if the last thing you do before you go to bed is write out your gratitudes, I don't see that being
it's not a negative, but
you know,
maybe it's worth doing something in the morning as well. So that's good advice.
I would think so. I mean, it's so easy for us, and we're all guilty for this, of grabbing our phones and looking through Instagram and YouTube videos and stuff. And there's a place for that, but, you know, I just think I work best when the first things that I do is for self-love and kind of filling up my tank, and then I can do those things, you know, throughout the day. But I want to at least give myself, you know, a half an hour to an hour a day of just, you know, some form of self-love where I'm reflecting on myself, seeing how I can improve and get better. I just feel better when I do that.
Now, you mentioned a couple minutes ago, you said that you have a girlfriend in Hamilton, but you live in Nashville.
Yeah.
That cannot be easy.
No.
So a lot of people, they talk about long distance relationships, mm-hmm. and how do you make that work?
I mean, it really comes, it's a two-way street, you know, so it comes down to the two individuals and, you know, how much are you willing to make it work? You know, mm-hmm. when you love somebody, some people after a while, they just can't do it, you know? And I would say 9 times out of 10, it probably wouldn't work if I'm being completely honest, but for us, it does. And we try to do things that, and boys, this might sound cornball, but well, you know, I'll do things with her where, like, when we FaceTime, we'll watch Netflix together at the same time, where we literally, okay, ready? 1, 2, 3, go.
Yeah.
And we're watching a show.
That's so cool. I do love that.
Yeah. And it makes the distance feel shorter. So finding things that we can do just to make that distance feel shorter is important. So as simple as Netflix and chill night.
Yeah.
If you can do that, that helps. Also, your goals, growing together is incredibly important. And I think if one of us were growing and the other person wasn't, you would probably grow apart. But we have very similar goals. You know, she's in the health and fitness world. She's into self-love and doing a lot of things that I'm into as well, too.
That helps.
So, yeah. So we hold each other accountable, and we're growing together, and we're trying to achieve similar goals. So so that helps as well, too, because we're still on the same journey, even if we're not in the same city, you know?
That makes a lot of sense, because there are a lot of people that try it, and it doesn't work. So those are some good tips.
And it's trust, you know? You got to trust each other. You got to, I mean, you know, I'm not much of I'll go out with friends to the bar and stuff, but it's not like I'm out in Nashville on Broadway.
Yeah.
You know?
Hey, ladies.
Yeah, do it. I'm not doing that every weekend, you know? I don't give more reasons for someone to think, like, well, he's out partying all the time and stuff. Not that it would matter if I did, but I think it's just easier that you just respect the individuals and, you know, I'd just rather spend my time being with my girl than, you know, going out and, you know, getting trashed.
Yeah.
I mean, I did that in my 20s. So.
Exactly. Yeah. So it sounds like you got everything together. Like, I mean, I feel like, you know, you're solid. It seems like you're on a great path. Mm-hmm. I mean, what is the future for you?
Well, I mean, there's some things that we have in the works right now that I can't discuss yet, but we're really excited about. But I would say this. I would say there's something with my mentoring, with the teaching, with my performing, songwriting, I could see that whole world coming together as well. So, you know, for me, you know, it's not necessarily like, you know, I want to climb the charts, or I want to do this, or I want to win the Grammys. I mean, I'd love to. I wouldn't say no.
Right.
You know what I mean? But it's not something that, like, fuels me to get all these accolades or anything like that. I want to find a way on how I can make a difference in other people's lives. And, you know, the only way I know to do that is through music and through, and through faith and love, you know? So I want to find a way on how I can do that through both worlds, with my mentoring, with my teaching, and obviously with the music that I create and perform.
That is unbelievable. And if people want to hear the music that you're creating now, where can they go and do that?
You can't go anywhere yet, yeah. But you will soon. So it'll be on, you know, iTunes, Apple, Spotify, all that stuff. But as of right now, we're still writing a ton, but hopefully soon.
So, you know, that leads me to my next question too, is that a lot of people think the music business is you win Canadian Idol. Mm. And that's it. But you work your butt off every single day.
Yeah.
And it's not like it's not really instant stars like people think. These are people that have worked for years and years and years to hone their craft. And then they write a good song. And it's kind of, so, I mean, you work your butt off every day.
Yeah. Yeah. You have to. You have to. And like I said earlier, it's kind of where the work begins. You know, the show is a launching pad, you know, and it helped expose me to this country and become a household name and get my music on radio and stuff. But that only helps for so long.
That's right.
And if you're going to ride on the coattails of that, it's going to fade away. So for me, you know, it's always on, you got to do it for the love. If you're doing it for the fame, if you're doing it for the money, you're in the wrong industry.
That's, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Because it's not there anymore. It's different. You know, the industry, you know, you've been in the game a long time and you know how much music has changed and how the industry's
very
changed.
Much.
So, you know, it's about how can I get great at my craft and can I impact people with what I'm doing? And that just takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of rejection. You're going to hear it. This is a no business, you know, and most people will say no. It doesn't mean that you're not good enough. It doesn't mean that you don't have what it takes. It's just there's different ways to do it now, you know. So, I mean, everyone defines what success is for them. And I think Bob Dylan said, if you wake up in the morning and go to bed at night and do what you love in between, you're a success. You know, and
that's a great piece of advice.
Yeah. And I try to remember that, you know, and I think, you know, I like you said earlier, you know, like reminding yourself to be grateful, I think, is one of the greatest tools that we have, and it costs nothing. You know, so I have my days too. Sure, I'll have those self-pity days here and there. And, you know, either myself or my girlfriend or a family friend or somebody will slap me in the head and say, snap out of it.
Yeah.
And now because I got these tools and I've learned throughout the way, I can snap out of it a lot quicker than I did before. But that's a part of the journey and that's what makes it awesome, you know? So for me, I mean, I don't know exactly what's in store, but I do know that music and people are always going to be a big part of my life. So we'll see how it unfolds. I'm just as excited as other people.
I am so excited because I can feel your energy and it's just so much like it's crazy. Like you have this like great energy about you.
Oh, thank you. You too.
It's unbelievable. And you were talking about, you know, being grateful every day.
Mm-hmm.
What are three things that you are grateful for, Brian Melo?
Oh man, if I'm going to bring it down to three things, family, number one, health, and man, just to be alive, man. I mean, like the odds of us being here is crazy, you know? So just to be here is such a gift, you know? And my life is just richer when I remind myself of those types of things.
Sounds like a song title. Just to be alive.
Just to be alive. All right.
You know?
All right. We got two now.
Two songs in the bucket, baby.
She's kind of pretty. Is that what you said before?
Yeah, she's kind of pretty. And what is it? Good day to be alive?
Good day to be alive?
I don't know.
Yeah.
We'll work on
we'll
it together.
We'll figure it out, yeah.
Thank you so much for coming by today.
Thanks so
I
much,
really
Sam.
Appreciate
it.
You've been amazing. And
Thank
I
you.
Literally wish you so much success.
Likewise.
You're amazing.
I appreciate you. Thank you.
Appreciate it.